Hello, I'm Dana Cadman, Director of Communications and Information Services at the EPC, and in this webinar I'm going to talk to you about creating a mission statement for your church. Now this is part four in a series on developing a communications plan for your church, so if you haven't seen the first three parts, you'll want to review those before you see this one, and especially make sure you pay attention and take notes in episode three where we talk about vision and values. Now, when talking about mission, I want to make sure everybody understands that a mission is different from a vision statement. Many organizations, churches and nonprofits, and even businesses confuse the term vision and mission. Many times they don't know what they are, so they have a vision and mission statement. They try to combine it all together. And in this webinar, I'm going to explain the difference between the vision and the mission. And just a quick review, vision should never change. And I covered that in webinar number three of this series. The vision is that on the horizon, way out there, goal that your organization will likely never achieve because it is so far out there, but it is what you're striving toward, and it's really the reason why your organization exists. If your vision ever changes, then something has changed in your organization, or if your organization changes, then your vision should change. But where that's different from mission, a mission should be reviewed every 3 to 5 years for adjustments or new missions. A mission is something that's temporary that gives you sort of marching orders toward your vision. And I've got the picture of the USS Enterprise from the Star Trek TV series up there. And if, you know, any of you remember the beginning of the episode, you know, Space, the Final Frontier, and they always talked about the 5-year mission of the Enterprise to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life and new civilizations, and to boldly go where no one has gone before. So it's, and I'll get into more detail. I'll kind of reference back to that because it's a mission statement that we're all kind of familiar with. And actually, it's a pretty good mission statement. Surprising that it comes from a TV show. But the mission of every ministry in your church is going to look a little different because each ministry has a different area of focus. So the mission statements for your ministries will be different. But they should all have one thing in common, and that's that they support the overall vision of the church. Because the church owns the vision, and each ministry then owns a mission. And the church itself can have one or more missions, and usually those come up from the ministries, but each ministry should only have one mission that it's working on, and that should be in support of the church's vision. And a mission statement, different from your vision, where a vision kind of, like I said, gives you that view out on the horizon, a mission empowers your church to be missional. Now that doesn't mean that because you have a mission statement you are missional, but it gets one of the necessary tools you need in order to become a missional church. The real value of mission is, when I say it gives you marching orders, it helps define the actions of your church. It develops a consistency and a cohesion to what you do, and that helps develop a brand. The brand of your church, to borrow from a marketing term, a brand is how people perceive your church. I mean, you can put out all kinds of flyers, and you can put it on the front of your web page and put it on the road sign by your church and say what your church is about. But your brand isn't really so much what you say you're about so much as what people outside your church say that you're about. So that's where that mission, that consistency of action and the way that you approach that action, that helps develop the brand for your church. And because of that, that's your mission is what visitors latch onto. When they are first investigating whether they want to attend your church or not. There's something about the activity at your church or something about what you do and why you're doing it that attracts them. And it's as they attend your church and become more exposed to your mission, that will help them determine to a large degree whether or not this is the church that they're going to attend. So establishing a mission isn't just something that you're doing to make a nice mission statement that you can put on a plaque. That's not the reason. The mission statement is to help motivate the people who are already at your church and help attract people to your church who want to become part of that mission. And hopefully, as a result of that, if they don't already have a relationship with Jesus Christ, that they'll come to develop that relationship as they get involved in the work of your church. Now, the other value of mission is that like I've already mentioned, it reinforces to your congregation why they're there. It helps develop that cohesion and consistency of activity. And when your church can explain its, or not even the whole church, when a ministry team can explain its mission, and that's even if they can't recite it word for word, but if they can explain fairly accurately to paraphrase what the activity of your ministry team is and what the overall vision of your church is, you've developed word-of-mouth advertising, which, as we all know, is the best type of advertising there is. You can, like I said, you can put it up on your webpage. You could pay for radio and TV ads. You can take out newspaper ads and whatever. But when people talk about what it is that your church is doing and, again, why they're doing it, that's what gets people excited and either attracts them to your church or it helps them decide that, hey, no, this isn't the church for me. And there's no problem with that. Because you don't want people in your church who are disgruntled because they think your church should be about one thing when it's about another, which is, you know, kind of a side benefit also of having mission and value well defined, is that people come into your church if your church does not have a well defined vision and mission, then people come in with kind of a blurry definition of what those are. They make assumptions, and then when those assumptions are shattered, they become disappointed in your church. So rather to have them realize up front that this isn't the church for me, rather than to invest 6 months, a year, maybe even 2 years in your church, and then finally realize, I've been wasting my time here. And, you know, without a mission statement, the people in your church are describing your church as they see it. And that's what I said, that kind of blurry vision. When people don't have a consistent mission that they can, you know, first off, integrate into their own personality and then rearticulate, then they make up a mission statement on their own. And that's how churches develop these fuzzy brands, because everybody's defining the church differently. Now, mission should be SMART. By SMART, it should be specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and time-driven. And I'll go through these. To be specific, your mission statement explains who is going to be involved in the mission and who the mission benefits. By measurable, it means that there needs to be some kind of metric. There's either going to be a number, a quality, or quality like a percentage or a fraction. There's going to be a time frame to it. There's going to be some measurable component to your mission statement that helps keep you accountable. Is it attainable? Do we have the resources? Because it's great to come up with these wonderful mission statements and realize we don't have the time for this. We don't have the people we need for it. We have people, but they don't have the skills. We don't have the facilities. We don't have the money. So we have to make sure our mission statement is something that we can attain, that we have the right resources for it. Is our mission statement relevant? Does our mission statement relate to our vision? Again, you can come up with a great mission statement, but if it doesn't support the vision of the church, number one, you're working at cross purposes to the church by draining resources from it for this mission. And the other thing, it helps dilute the brand of that church. People get, again, a confused message about what the church is about. So you've got to make sure the mission statement is relevant. And then also time-driven, do we have deadlines in there, or is there a time frame for our mission to be accomplished? Again, you know, the enterprise's five-year mission. Well, okay, after 5 years, then we're going to go out and get a different mission. Or maybe decide that this mission is still good and we'll do it for another 5 years. But that's where you need to constantly, you know, review things. Okay, so this is the part of the program now where you can start picking up your stones and casting them at me, because we're going to look at a mission example here. And it's one that probably some of you have some variation of. And I've seen, not just in EPC churches, but in churches in various denominations, I see a mission statement, something to the effect of, to reach the unchurched for Christ and help them grow the relationship so they can reach the unchurched for Christ. First problem with that is that this work is inherent in all churches. It's like saying that you value honesty and integrity in your church. Well, what church doesn't value honesty and integrity? I mean, those are kind of implied in being a church, just like implied in being a church is that you're reaching the unchurched for Christ. That should be a given. So first off, it's not a very good mission, because it's it's not something that the church has really owned by developing it on its own. The other thing is that this is more of a vision statement. It lacks a lot of the SMART components. Again, that time frame or quantity, the accountable metrics that we need. It's more of an activity rather than a state of being, which activity is really what a mission is about, where a state of existence or being is what a vision is about. So now this is obviously derived from the Great Commission. I'm not saying that we ignore this, but like I said, this should be inherent to all churches. So if this is the best you can do for a mission statement, I would propose back to you that you haven't really spent a lot of time thinking about your church's vision or mission, or why it is God has you, where He has you, and why He has you there right now. And these are things that you should really, delve into and think about. Okay, let's look at an example here. Okay, so taking the vision statement, you know, something for the church universal, your church wants to help foster a world where every person is in a growing relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, I could have said to see a world where every person is in a growing relationship with Jesus Christ, but I wanted to use the phrase help foster because it puts a little bit different spin on the vision. Because if you want to see a world, then you need to be more actively engaged in that making of discipleships and such. Whereas when you want to help foster a world, that doesn't mean that you're not involved in the work of evangelism, but maybe you're going to do something that helps support evangelistic activity. So, see, the selection of words is very, very important in your vision and your mission statements, because just a change of a couple words here and there does put a different emphasis on what that vision is about. Now, in the example here for values, our church values collaboration, service, and community. By that collaboration, we like working with each other in our church. We like working with people outside of our church. A lot of people in our church have the gift of helps, or maybe the gift of administration. We just like to pitch in and do work. We also value community, which means community in our church and community within our local community. We like to reach out to people. We like to invite people in. Once people are invited into what activity we're doing, we keep re-inviting them. And this is where I see some churches fail, is that you invite people in and you assume that once, you know, they're involved in a ministry team or a Bible study or something, that everything's good, instead of continually getting back to them, hey, are we meeting your needs? Are you doing okay? Are you involved in a team? Are you growing in Christ? That's something that churches, at least some of the churches I've had some involvement with, they're very good at bringing people in, but not so good at keeping people there because they don't do that good follow-up. And so, anyway, I just wanted to spend that little bit of time talking about what it means to be in community. So based on this vision and based on these values, the mission for this particular church is to equip one ministry team each year. So now, okay, we've got one ministry team, there's our measurable aspect, and each year, so we have a deadline. Every year we're going to equip one ministry team so that it can witness in word and deed. Now, we're not saying how they're going to witness. We're just saying that they're going to do this, but we're not saying how. So we haven't pigeonholed them or hamstrung them into a certain amount of constraints, that each ministry team is kind of free to pursue its own way to witness in word and deed to local people groups. So again, you know, we're being very specific here. This activity does not apply to people in the region or across the country or in other countries. We're talking about in our community. And we're going to work in collaboration with existing community networks. In other words, we're a church that's not really very good at inventing the wheel or creating new ministries. But boy, you give us something that's maybe it's not even going well. It's just started. We will be there with shovels. We will be there with pails. We will be there with spatulas and cooking utensils and paintbrushes and blankets and whatever is needed. We will be there because that's the kind of church we are. So now the church has a mission that every year, and for some churches this could be really easy, for other churches, equipping one ministry team each year, just raising up the people to be on the team each year could be a struggle, let alone equipping them. But at least you've got something, you've got your marching orders that you're working toward. And if you accomplish these each year, then great, and then you can look and see what else maybe God has for you. And if you're really struggling to do this, you can maybe step back and go, you know, were we a little too ambitious? Or do we have the right mission, but we just need to approach it a little differently? So how do you create your mission? Well, first off, you got your vision statement all set. So the next thing you want to do is brainstorm a list of actions you can take to accomplish that vision. And here's where we kind of throw out that whole attainable part. Do we have the resources that are necessary? Now we're just going to dream big. You know, let's brainstorm every possible action that we could take that could support our vision. And then we want to make sure that, you know, after we come up with these things, let's do a double check here and make sure that all these things we brainstorm somehow leverage our values. Okay, now if we come up with things that might sound really good, but they don't leverage our values, that means that it's going to be an activity kind of difficult for us to get people motivated behind, because we're asking people with different values to do this particular mission activity. So we might throw some of our brainstormed ideas out because they just don't leverage the values that our church holds. So the next thing we need to do is, of the mission activities that are left, we need to prioritize them. And you can there's different ways you can prioritize mission statements, but the two most common is either number one, by what's most attainable. We can do this one because we have everything we need to accomplish this. All we need to do is just start doing it. We're all set. Or you could take the approach, what is most important? And that's what people kind of lean toward, but the caution that goes with that is that you may look and say, you know, if there is only one thing, we've got 20 items up on the board here or wherever, and of these 20 things, if we only did this one thing, that would make a greater impact on our community than all the other 19 that are on this list. So that's the one we have to do. But you're going to have to look at it. Now you're going to have to look at that attainable portion of SMART. Do we have the resources? And maybe you have all of them. Maybe you have a few. If you don't have any of them, then, you know, God can always work miracles. But I would just really, really caution you to go in prayer to God and say, you know, this is a mission you've given us, or we feel this is what we're called toward. We have none of the resources we need for this. So what are we going to do while we wait for these these resources to show up, or how are we going to go out and find these resources? But after you've eliminated the ones that don't leverage your values, after you've prioritized them, after you made sure it's SMART, you can now begin assigning one mission to each ministry. Because, again, let's say we've got 20 mission statements up here, and of them we've determined that we apply the SMART principle, and out of these 20 we can do 10 of them. Well, which one are we going to do first? Depending upon how well-resourced your church is, you can say, you know what, we're going to do one, and this is the one we're going to do. Or you can say, you know what, we can do these three because we've got ministry teams in place who can take on each of these three challenges. So that's where you start assigning. Of course, that means that the other seven are going to wait. You don't throw them away. You don't forget them. You put them somewhere so that, you know, each year as you go back through and review mission statements, you can say, can we take on one of these other seven that we couldn't take on last year? And then, of course, you know, you go through the brainstorming activity again, too, because your congregation is going to change. The community in which your church ministers is going to change. And that community could be local. It could be, you know, halfway around the globe. As the community changes and as your church changes, you might come up with new mission statements. So wrapping up here, we looked at your mission statement again, how it's different from your vision, and I just can't emphasize that enough, how different that is. Now we have a conversation already started on EPC community for church communications plan. So if you had any questions about either this presentation or any of the others in this series, if you want to make a comment, if you want to disagree with anything I've said, you know, I love to get different perspectives. If you have resources, maybe you know an online tool that helps you brainstorm mission statements, that'd be great. Please share that. And that can all be shared in EPC community. And if you don't have the access code for that, the access code is EPC1981, and that's capital E, capital P, capital C. It is case sensitive. So with that access code, you can create a profile and join these conversations. And then also, don't forget to come to EPC's main website and download the slides for this presentation. Also, you know, join us on Facebook and Twitter. Let us know that you're out there. I'm almost each, probably once a week since this last General Assembly, I'm discovering a church that's on Facebook that I wasn't aware of. And now that I am aware of it, we can follow them, and we'd love to, you know, reshare information that you share. Same thing with Twitter. We're also on Flickr, Google+, and Pinterest. Please join us there. And if you have time, please send me a picture of your church. I'd love to post it on our Flickr and Pinterest pages. And you can send those to me, Dana, D-A-N-A, .Cadman, C-A-D-M-A-N, at epc.org. So again, I hope this information was useful to you, and I look forward to seeing your conversation there on EPC Community. Thanks.